So last week we talked about global motion estimation, and we in particular discussed two methods. One was by Bergen and others. It uses the affine transformation between two images, which is six parameters, and this is actually the program, third program you are going to implement after you finish the SIFT. Then we also talk about Mann and Picard algorithm, which has these three parts. One is the homography, the projector transformation, and the first method was just a weighted, which is kind of approximate because there's a denominator in the projector transformation, we just multiply that. And then we look at the approximation of the projector transformation using the Taylor series. And we talked about two methods. One was bilinear, other was a pseudo-perspective method. So now this give you a global flow compared to the local flow, which is optical flow. It also is called registration, that we can register one image with other. As I gave you an example, if you have like two images and you want to align them together, then this transformation will help you, and that's why it's called alignment also. And the motion compensation, if you have video where the camera is moving and you want to get rid of camera motion, just focus on the object motion, then this kind of estimation will help you. And also parametric motion estimation. So these are the different names are used for the exactly same thing. So you should be aware of that, and warping also, because once you know the transformation, you can apply the transformation to the image, and that's called warping. Warping means you change the image according to the how the pixels are warped, pixels are mapped using this transformation which you estimated. Okay, so as we have been talking about, the reason we want to know that, we want to learn it, because there are lots of application of this kind of work. So if you have a camera which is jittering and the video is not really pleasant to watch, then this kind of thing will estimate the motion, compensate and remove that motion, then video will become stable. Or if the video is obtained from UAV, UAV is moving and you are more interested on the objects which are moving, the cars, the people and so on. So this will help you to remove the camera motion and just focus on the object motion. It'll give you a video set that, for example, camera was stationary actually. Okay, and I've shown you those videos. So with that also we can detect the objects which are moving just by subtracting, because if the camera is fixed, when objects are moving, the thing which changes the objects. So you take one image, subtract from other image, the background will be same in both images, but what will change will be the objects, and we can find out those objects moving by subtraction. But if the camera is moving and objects are moving, when you subtract two frames, then almost everything will be moving, and that's a problem. So that's why motion compensation will help us to remove the global motion and focus on the local motion of the objects. Okay, and we talk about that we can generate a mosaic. We can take these images and put them together and make a big image. And it's like a similar to jigsaw puzzle, that you have different pieces of jigsaw puzzle. You as a human know that how to connect them. Now how does the computer know? And computer essentially will be able to do that by finite transformation, estimating transformation, then putting it together. And the example I gave you is, if I take a video of this wall, then I cannot take whole wall in one image. So I'll take a video and then I can stitch them together. And this stitching I cannot do by a computer program if I don't know how to transform this image with other image. And this is what your global estimation is going to do there. And also there's a good application of this is called georegistration. So if you have a Google Earth image, you know, where every pixel in the image has a GPS location, the longitude, latitude. So now as you took a picture, somebody took a picture, you want to know where that picture was taken. then you can go to Google Alert and register that picture with the Google Alert, and now then you every pixel you know where that picture was taken. You can know GPS location because of register with the Google Alerts. Okay, so that's a very good application of this kind of thing. And the final application is tracking, and that's what we are going to talk about today. And tracking again is a very important topic and is still very active area of research. In particular, we are going to talk about what is called KLT tracker. Tracking method, which is called KLT, and that is based on what you have learned so far. And that will be really interesting application of this global motion, or affine transformation, alignment, and all those things we talk about, that you can actually write a program to track some objects. And it's a very useful thing to be able to do. So tracking deals with estimating trajectory of an object and in the image planes as it moves around a scene. So we want to find out the trajectory of the object, how it's moving in the from frame 1 to frame 2, frame 2 to 3, and so on. And trajectory will be a center of the object, centroid of object. So that is what tracking deals with. Now we can track objects like a car, person, airplane. We can actually track features. We can take an image, apply feature detector, say here is feature detector, and for each feature point, we can find out, given the location frame 1, where does go frame 2, frame 3, and so on. We can have feature tracking, and there can be several features on one object. And so there are different variations of the object tracking. We can track a single object, let's say in a whole video there's only one object, and it's the easiest problem to track that. But more realistic is that, you know, there are multiple objects. You know, there are five objects, and we get confused. Say, well, there are five objects here, five objects there, but now how do we know this object actually same as the object in the next frame, and this is the same in this frame, and so on. So that becomes more complicated. Now, and another variation of tracking is that camera can be moving, as I told you, and that's you have to do motion compensation, then do the tracking. And then the other thing is that when we have multiple cameras, when they are looking at the scene and you are tracking in one camera, then the objects go from one field of view to other camera, field of view, and next camera. So how do we do the handover? That's another very interesting research problem. So I'm going to show you some examples to just motivate, and I think one of your guys sent me email that I should give you a lot of examples to motivate you why we have all these equations and what we are trying to do. So here's the example of tracking a single point in the video. And as you see, these are pretty complicated videos, but most of our time we are actually tracking pretty well. And it is moving, it is zooming in, now we lost it. This left one, and it's still the other two, now the second one is lost. And then the third one is just going. So that essentially is tracking, that we say, well, this point I want to track, it's keep moving, I know where it is, and so on. Okay, so we want to be able to do that. So this is one very simple case of tracking a single point on a target. There's another variation there where we want to track a bounding box. So we put a box or a window around the object we want to track. Here are the people. And then each person has a different ID or color, so green and red. And we want to have the same ID throughout the video. So that is the tracking. Tracking of people where each person is represented by a bounding box. Okay, so here as you see, also we have some objects, and then there'll be a car coming in. We can speed this up. And we have other things going on, and this is the example of a tracking. So we can do even better there, where we can track the whole contour, where we have very fine information about the object, not just a bounding box, but we know exactly how the object is deforming, and we have a pretty good idea of the target. And this is another example of, you know, these images here. Also, we can take a contour, track a contour of the object. So then this is an example where we want to be able to track between three cameras. So we have camera one, camera two, and camera three, and we want to be able to track in camera one when the object goes left the camera one field of view. It comes in camera two field of view. It should be have the same label. So we have this handover. As you see, that in this case the person has the same label, either the blue or green or red, I think, and which is, you know, again a harder problem to solve, because, you know, we are not only taking one camera, and these people look a little different in the other camera, but you can, you know, solve this. So I'm going to play you again so you can understand what is happening here. So the only first person will come in here, will assign a new label, then another person comes in, and then this person will stay here, red, and then there'll be third person, you know, which is yellow or, you know, blue, and so he has the same label, blue, in all these, and then the third guy is going to start walking again. He will have same red label in all these three. So these are much more complicated tracking in multiple camera, because when you want to cover a big area, one camera is not enough. So you want to put lots of cameras to cover the whole area. Okay, so it's an interesting area. And the previous case was where we had the field of view of cameras were overlapping. So we can see when the person is in this camera, he goes out and come to the next camera. So it's overlapping field of view. But the next complicated case is that when the field of view are not overlapping. So this is one camera field of view, this is another one. So the person will get out and we won't know anything. We don't know where the person is. Then the person will appear here. Now when it appears here, we want to assign the same label, because, you know, that's the camera tracking across cameras. Okay? So here's an example. We did this work a few years ago. So we are assigning these labels to different people, and you remember these labels. Now after some time they will appear in this field of view, the second camera, and they should have same label. So that is the most complicated case of the moving the cameras. In this case, I can reduce this a little bit so you can see a little better. Okay, so see, now this guy has same label as it was in the before, same label. This is a different label for that guy as it was. So three people have same label handovers done, which is, you know, amazing. So that is interesting. And then the last thing is, I have showed you before that we want to track these objects in a moving camera. These are UAV videos, and as you see, that each of this car has a one same color, let me play this again. Same color throughout, which means that we are tracking the same thing. It's a green or yellow or blue, and that is the track. And it's useful that while where the car enters, where it's going, and we need to keep track of. That's what the idea of this, you know, surveillance is. Okay, so the tracking is very active area of research. Not next week, a week from next week, there's a major conference called ECCV, European Conference on Computer Vision. And that's one of the most prestigious conference in computer vision, every 2 years. And the acceptance rate is, you know, about 20%. You know, 80% of papers are rejected. It's very, very high, you know, quality conference. So, for example, there we have two papers on tracking. These are tracking for the human tracking. I'm going to give you an example. So you can actually look at, we had a nice presentation about this paper and in the YouTube, if you want to learn more about it. Same place where we have the video lectures. We have another paper also on tracking, different method. Also, we have a YouTube on that. So here is the idea. So this is a much more complicated tracking because we have lots of people. And the idea here is that we want to assign same color to the object throughout the frames. So we are tracking that correctly. And as you see, if you watch this carefully, I'm going to play this again, that all these colors remain the same. And we have lots of frames. So the top here is a frame number. And we are playing this video quickly because there are too many frames to show you more than 500. I think there are total 800 frames or something. So this is example of this tracking by using one method. And then we have another method where we can track in this kind of sequence. Now, as you see, there are many, many people, because tracking becomes hard when you have lots of objects. If you have just one object, it's very easy. Now, as you see that we have tracks for these objects, each has a different color, and we are showing this track for that. Okay? And and it's a very complicated, because there's occlusion, there is, you know, people go behind, and so on. Then there is here in the sequence, again, a very difficult sequence, many people, and we can track these pretty well. And this is, you know, probably the best method currently we have in the area, in the research area, which give very good results, because these are standard sequences. We can compute the performance measure, and the reason this was accepted because this is a very good results. So if you want to, you know, learn more about, you can watch this YouTube video. Now, next thing in this thing is, which is more interesting, is that we can not only track the human, but we can track also the people, the parts of a human. So here you will see that we are tracking the parts of one of the person here, as you see and shown here, somewhere here. And so, which is pretty challenging. And these are the parts which we are showing here, different parts. There are 8 parts of a person: left arm, right arm, head, and torso. And those tracks which are shown here, you know, looks pretty good. And this is another example where we are tracking also the parts of a person, which will be shown around here. So that is the tracking problem. And tracking multiple people in a crowded scene, and tracking then parts of each person, that we know what the person is doing, not only just, you know, have a track. So we'll have basically 8 trajectories correspond each part of the person. Yes. Yeah, this is a high resolution. I think, what's the resolution? It's about 1080p or something. So it's a high resolution video, because you know, in order to see each part, you know, you need lots of pixels. So that is fact. But these days, I mean, the resolution is not a problem. You can get, you know, very good resolution iPhone, even, you know, the yeah, there are some better ones. Actually, this Wen Hui is a co-author of this paper, so you can talk to him for more questions. Okay, so so that's tracking. Now the question is, so you are convinced tracking is important, a lot of application, it's, you know, something challenging we should do. And the question is, how do we do it, what we know so far? What you have learned so far, I will motivate you that you can do tracking, and which is very good. So let's look at the simple, very simple problem. So we have a video with one object moving like this. Okay? So these are different frames, and objects moving like this. And which means a frame 1 looks like that, frame 2 looks like that, 3, 4, and so on. So we have sequence of frame, object is moving like that. So now you want to ask yourself, say, I want to track one point on this object, like this point. what I know so far, how can I track? What can I do to find out this spine where it go next frame, and this spine where it go next frame, and so on? What can I do? Any thoughts? Any? How would you find out the motion of this corner from one frame to other frame? What do you do normally? Huh? More question?
Searching around in the position of the center in a previous frame.
Okay, so what you have learned to find the motion of a point from one frame to other frame? That's called optical flow. Okay, so if you find the optical flow at this point in this frame, optical flow at this point in this frame, optical flow at this point in this frame, then you basically can track that point, is that right? So that's what the simplest case of tracking is that. So we have optical flow, we computed like that, Lucas Kanade. Then from here, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and we take all those connected over there, and this is a track of this point, and you are doing tracking. So it's very simple, right? It's not that hard that you can do tracking like that. So you find the optical flow of this point. It tells you it went here at this point in the next frame. Then you use that in the second and third frame. You compute this one for this point. Then you look at this point, then compute this and that, like that. And you link them together because it says it goes here. From here it goes here. From here it goes here. And that's what this track is. So it's not that hard, you know, to track a single point on the object, and there's one object there. Now this motion is translation, that this object is translating only. That's, you know, we can do that using optical flow. Okay, so that essentially is the simple KLT algorithm, which is Kanade Lucas Tomasi. Remember the Lucas Kanade? Lucas was a student under Kanade, did this work on the optical flow or stereo. Then Tomasi was another student of Kanade, and he modified this, and that's why it's called KLT tracking, or KLT alignment, or KLT algorithm. So at the high level, this is extremely simple. What it's going to do, detect Harris corners in the first frame, and you know we have talked about how to detect Harris corners. Then for each Harris corner point, we will compute the motion. Now if you just want translation, you will compute local motion using optical flow. But if you want more complex transformation like rotation, scaling, and so on, then we can compute the local affine transformation, which we have talked about, you know, last time. And we are going to do this between consecutive frames. So then we will link these motion vectors from frame to frame to get the tracks of Harris points. And that's it, basically. Now, we may have that while these corners may disappear, and maybe there are some other objects will appear, and we can then detect periodically corners in every 15th frame or every 10th frame and start tracking those. No? So that's the next step. Introduce new Harris points by applying Harris detector to every 15, 10 or 15 frames, and start tracking those points, and the points which we have before we can keep tracking. Okay? So it's pretty simple, very, very easy. And so if you do that, then this is kind of results you will get. So here we want to track different points on these fish. So as you see, there are these trajectories, and we are able to track them for quite many frames. These trajectories are shown in different colors, and it's a fun thing to do. And we can track them, you know, pretty long time. So I'll show you several examples. This is another example where we have these Harris points on the keyboard, on the keys of that, as shown in this little red squares. and they are being tracked. So of course, there are some errors. There will be some new ones introduced, or some will be deleted, and so on. But the basic idea is pretty simple, which you are ready to actually write this program yourself, because you know everything, the theory and how to write a program. This is also interesting. What happened? So here you will see that there are, you know, different objects moving. There are different points on each object, and these are Harris points, and we are tracking those, and we are linking them, and then coming up with the tracks, the trajectories. And you can do this for a long time, as you see here. That's working out pretty well. And the points which are not moving would just stay there, which are shown in the red. But this object is moving, so you know it's actually showing the tracks of this object. Okay, so this is another one similar to before. There'll be, you know, this beer can, and there'll be points, and it's going to rotate, and then you can still keep track of these points pretty well. With some new points, and will disappear. So this is the most interesting, I think, here. So here, what we are showing, actually, these are the flow vectors for each of the point. You know, that with the arrow, which direction the motion is moving, its motion is happening. You know, the all these points are showing as the optical flow vectors change. So he's moving, then he has, you know, these different direction vectors. He's dancing. So this sequence is called dancing. So you can do that, you know, all these things, which is exciting. So not only, you know, you can write a program, do fun things, but you know what you are doing, and, you know, the math and all these things. Yes?
What the color is?
Color represents, you know, sometimes it represents the direction of motion, you know. And this thing, I think there is a direction of motion, because all these are green, as you see here, and these points are moving this way, direction of motion. So you take the motion, divide in 360 degrees, you have used a color wheel that, you know, different directions. Okay? So it's fun. So now we'll come back to that, say, well, we know Lucas Canale, we can do translation, but as you see, some of these were not just translation, they are affine, there's rotation, there's scaling, and so on. So which means we are going to talk about, again, the given two frames, given two patches, in patch in one frame one, patch in frame two, and they'll be local patches. We don't have to apply the whole global motion, find out affine transformation between those two patches. So exactly same method as we talk about global motion estimation, which was using the whole image, all the pixels, we can essentially apply the same method for the small page, which is page can be of object, or a page can be around a Harris point, okay? And that is called, given two pages, can you find the transformation between those two? Can you align those pages? Can you register them? There's all these different names, so this is exactly the same thing. So how to estimate alignment, how to estimate this transformation. So listen to this very carefully. This is, in a way, will be a review what we have done, but this will give you a little different perspective. Okay, so first is that we have been talking about that given two images, what are the possible transformation between two images, you know? So let's say we have object here. Now it can translate, it can become like that. This is one simple transformation. Or we have object here, and it can rotate and translate, which is called Euclidean or rigid transformation. We have object here, and it can have scale and rotation in the translation, which is called similarity transformation. And this is a transformation we have affined, which can include everything, the translation, the rotation, the scaling, all those things are captured in the six parameters here. And the projective is even more general, which include everything. So these are the basic set of 2D transformation. And this figure is from the book by Rick Zaleski, which you have access to. So that's thing, that's kind of review of what you need to know. And it's important, this kind of thing will be asked in the exam. Okay? Now, again, we have written these in equations form also. So if I have a location of object in frame 1, which is x, y, then I apply a translation in x is b1, translation y at b2, then the location of that object in frame 2 will be x prime, y prime. Very simple, very trivial. Okay? And this is the rigid transformation, which includes the rotation around z-axis and the translation. So first apply the rotation, and this rotation matrix we have done, and then we add the translation. Okay? So that is the rigid transformation. Then affine, we have these four parameters, the a1 to a4, and b1 to b2, and that's an affine transformation. Okay? And the projective is eight parameters, which is the numerator and denominator, like that. So these are just review. We have done that, and you need to know that, and there's nothing fancy about it. It's pretty simple, intuitive, trivial, and I gave you the figure to explain what these transformations represent. Okay? Now then we have the approximation of these transformation. Because this projective is numerator denominator, we can do the Taylor series up to second order, and that's a part of the homework, and becomes like that. Now this has 12 unknowns, but now they are linear. And the bilinear, we will get rid of the square terms, we'll have the 8 terms here. And then pseudo perspective, we will do more manipulation and have similar coefficient in these couple of these, and we'll end up with this pseudo perspective transformation. So that is one thing which you need to know very well, and this will be used again and again here. Okay, the second thing we want to do, which will help us to come up with this alignment method for particular scale T, we are going to look at this transformation as a function. And this function we'll call W function, and our warping function. So this is a function which has two parameters, parameter vectors called P. One parameter is B1, other parameter is B2. So as you see here, you take X, but add the B1, become X prime, take Y, add B2, become Y prime. So that's what the same thing we have here. Now this function is of the two variable, in a way, two parameters, B1, B2, and it is the vector value function. See, normally the function you are used to, you get f of x, you get a scalar value. F of x is a scalar. But here, the function w give us two values. This is one value, this is another value. It's a vector value function, okay? That's what, you know, it's nothing new, but you need to understand that. So same way, we have a rigid transformation where, you know, we rotate first and add the translation, and we can write down this again, a function, vector value function. And this function will be like this. Again, the parameters as p. Here we have three parameters, the theta and b1, b2. Here we have two parameters, b1, b2. So this is the first function, and this is the second function. This function has two values. It's a vector value function. It's a two-dimensional vector. It's like that. So, which is nice. Now, fine. Again, we have the one part of the function is this one, and the part is this one, and we can write down like this. Function is of six variables, a1, a2, a3, a4, and then b1, b2. And this is first part of the function, second part. So that is called warping function, you know, and this we are going to use it when we estimate this transformation. This can be called transformation also. This is a transformation in a function form. Mm-hmm. So we can also write down this in a matrix form.
Now we have x, y, 1. We have this matrix, which we got from here. If you multiply this with the first row, it will be x plus 0 plus b1, which is first equation. 0, y plus b2 is second equation. So this is exactly same as this one, and this is exactly same as this one, but it's a different way to express this warp or the transformation. And as you see here, that we have added one additional here, one element here. So this xy used to be just two dimension, now it's a three dimension. And this is called homogeneous coordinates. Just we add one for convenience, so we can write down this is a matrix and the vector multiplication. If we didn't have one here, then it'd be very hard to multiply two-dimensional vector with three-dimensional row. So that's a problem. So that's why we are going to add one more, and it's okay. So similarly, now what will be the warp for this one? What should be the matrix? Anybody can? What should be the matrix first element of for this one? I want to write down like this. What should be? What? X. First element of the matrix will be what? It's not x. X will be out here. Cos theta minus sine theta b1. And second one will be sine theta cos theta b2. And that's what we have. And I'm just using the simplified notation. C theta means cos theta, S theta means sine theta, and so on. Okay? So you're getting better now. So let's look at now, how do we write down this in the matrix form? What will be the matrix, the first row of matrix? A1, A2, and this one. Okay? So is this, I forgot here something? Yeah, so we'll put that four. So that's nice. And we have put these warp function in a matrix form. We know it's the vector value function, warp, and we can, instead of this, we can just say this is a matrix A. It's like that. And this is a 3 by 2 matrix because it's 2 by 3 matrix because there's 2 rows and 3 columns. So that's very nice. Okay. So this is the actually table from Rick Zaleski's book, and that's what this essentially is saying, that translation has 2 degrees of freedom, B1, B2, and it preserves orientation, that you know, if you take the object, you translate anywhere, orientation will remain same. Rigid transformation has the 3 degrees of freedom, the rotation and the 2 translations, the theta and translation, and it will preserve the lengths will not change. If you rotate something, lengths will remain the same. Similarity has 4, the scaling, the rotation, theta, and 2 translation, B1, B2, and it will preserve the angles between the objects. You know, these angles will remain the same. This is 90 degrees, you know, it was 90 degrees there. Affine has the 6 parameters, as you know, and it will preserve the parallelism. If the lines are parallel, if you apply the affine transformation, they will remain parallel. And perspective transformation, homography, is this one, 3 by 3, it has 8 parameters and preserve the straight line. So it's nice kind of review of these transformations. Okay, so the next thing we are going to talk about is the derivatives of these functions. And we have talked about this before, but just to refresh you, if I have a function f, it's a function of one variable, and we can find its derivative. Derivative of function f with respect to x. X is a scalar. Now, if I have a function of the multiple variables, you know, n variables, like in the image is a function of 2 variables, then I have to find the gradient. So, which will be the derivative of f with respect to first variable, then second, third, and so on. These are called partial derivatives. So, gradient is derivative of f with respect to x, derivative of f with respect to y. So, that's, you know that. Okay, now there's a notion of what is called Jacobian. As you saw, the function we have there for the warp or the transformation is a vector value function. The value we get of a function at a given point is not scalar. It's two values, as you saw before. So x prime and y prime. So therefore, the question is, how do we find the derivative of vector value function, which is shown like here? So we have one function, f1, which is a function of n variables, another function, function of n variables, we have m function like this. And this is called vector value function of n variable. Okay? So what we are going to do for this one is actually when we find the derivative of this, it will become a matrix, not a vector. And it's logical because we are going to differentiate the first function with respect to x1, x2, x3, xn. We'll tell you first row. We'll take the second function f2, we'll differentiate that with respect to x1, x2, xn. And that is called Jacobian. And that is Jacobian. The first row is the first derivative of this first function. Second row is derivative of second function. All of these n derivatives and so on is called Jacobian. And the reason it's called Jacobian, there was this famous researcher called Carl Jacobi from Germany. He was born in 1800 or so, and he came up with this idea, and as a tribute to him, everybody's calling it Jacobi, and even though it's a pretty simple idea. So one day maybe one of you guys will have something and you will remember after 200 years. Okay, that's the beauty of science. Okay, so Jacobian we know, and which is good. So now we go back to our these warp functions, the displacement model, and we want to find Jacobians on it because that's what we are going to use. Okay, so again, this is was a translation warp function. So here the parameters are b1, b2. So we want to find the Jacobian of this, which means we want to differentiate this first function with respect to first parameter, and differentiate this one with respect to second parameter. Then differentiate this second function with the first parameter, and then with respect to second parameter. So what will be the first row of Jacobian for this? If I differentiate this with respect to first parameter, what will I get?
B1
is a parameter, and B2 is parameter. So I want to differentiate this with respect to B1, what I will get?
1.
Yes. I will differentiate this with respect to B1 will be 1. Differentiate this with respect to B2 will be 0. So first row will be 1, 0. Differentiate this with respect to B1 will be 0. And with B2 will be 1. So that's my Jacobian. Very nice. Simple. So now let's find out Jacobian for this one. So this again parameters are theta, B1, B2. So if I differentiate this with respect to B1, the first function, what will be?
1.
And with B2 and theta?
Minus
x cos sine theta and minus y cos theta. Okay, so you got an idea, which is shown here. So 1, 0, and this, and then differentiate this with respect to b1, b2, and theta, which is shown here. So it's pretty nice. And so that's called Jacobian. So let's now look at Jacobian of the affine. So affine has 6 parameters, okay? A1, A2, B1, B2, A2, A3, A4. So and again there are these two functions. So we'll differentiate this with respect to A1, with respect to A2, A3, A4, B1, B2. And some again here. So it'll be a 2 by 6. So first element will be 1 from here. There is no if I differentiate this with respect to the with respect to B1, yeah, okay, maybe it's B1, that's right. This is with respect to B1 is 1, with respect to B2 is 0, with respect to A1 is X, with respect to A2 is Y, and then B2 and A3, A4 are all 0. Then similarly, you can take this one with respect to B1 is 0 and B2 is 1 and so on like that. Okay? So it's pretty good. And it's simple, it makes sense, it's Jacobian. Okay? So now that's what this is. Again, the figure from Rick Zaleski's book. So this you have already shown, seen degrees of freedom and what preserves. And then these are the Jacobians, which we just tried. And these are the parameters. So which you should, look at this thing. Yes? No, Jacobian is just notion, it's a finer derivative of a vector value function. So it's just, as we find a derivative of a image, which is a gradient, which tells you edges and so on. So this is another function, vector value, we want to find derivative. We are going to use it to find the alignment. But it's just a notion, mathematical notion, which we are going to use it. Okay? So now with that, now we are going to talk about the alignment. So the alignment again is that we are giving a template here. This is actually Takeo Kanade. This is a picture of the Kanade, the professor, researcher in Carnegie Mellon who started this whole thing. So these guys, Baker was the, Simon Baker was another, he was a postdoc at CMU and he continued this Lucas Kanade, Tomasi, all the work. He wrote a very interesting paper in 2004. With the title is 20 years of, 2 decades of Lucas Kanade method. I'm going to show you title. So this figure is taken from that paper and it's also in the Rick Zaleski's book. So this is Professor Kanade here. And so what we want to do, we have a template here. We want to find the alignment between this and this so that when we find the alignment, find the transformation, this will look like this. Because, as you see, there's a translation, there is rotation, there's scaling, they're not exactly same. So that's what we want to find out. And the method is very similar to the method we talked about, Bergen et al. Previously, but it's a little different perspective, and you will, you will understand this when we go through that. Okay, so what we want to do, again here, we want to find out the parameters. These are the parameters of what we want to find out. These are the, if it is only translation, we want to find out B1, B2. If it is a rigid, we want to find out a theta and B1, B2. If it's affine, we want to find out all 6. A1 to A4, B1 and B2. So now the way we are going to find out is this, that we have a template. We want to say what warp or what transformation we apply to I, that image I showed you, page of image, so that every pixel by pixel, it is very similar to a template. So you want to minimize the sum of the square differences, and you have seen this before. So you want to find out, we want to transform I, and in order to transform I, we want to know this W, the warp function, which we have been talking about. And knowing warp function means we need to know the parameters P. In different motion model, we have different parameters. And if we know how to do it, then we are done. We know the alignment. So that's the formulation we start with. So this summation is over all pixels, and we want to estimate the P, the parameter vector. Okay? So now we are going to do again the same way as we did before. We are going to say we have somehow initial estimate of P. So we are going to estimate the change in P, which we'll call delta P, okay, as we did, last time. So therefore, we are going to change this one, x plus delta P, and this whole thing is same. So that's the function we want to minimize. We want to find delta P, so this is minimized, and this is in terms of the sum of the square differences of the template and the image which we want to warp, which we want to match to. And that makes sense because then they are aligned. If this sum of square difference is exactly 0, then best alignment. So what we do? So we will take this one and we are going to k get a Taylor series of this. You know, again, the Taylor series, you have seen this before many, many times. So Taylor series give you approximation of this function, and it makes things easier. And we are going to do Taylor series of only first order term around xp. So when you find a Taylor series of this, so we'll have value of this function at that point, xp. Then the derivative of this function, and this derivative will be, will differentiate I, which is shown here. Then this is I, the function of w, will differentiate w, and w is then function of p, will differentiate w with respect to p. And w is a warp function, and we are differentiating w, which is a vector value function, with respect to p, which is a vector, and that is the Jacobian. Remember, that's what we have been computing, the derivative of w with respect to p, and that's a Jacobian. If we have translation model, we'll take that Jacobian. If you have Hessian, if you have the affine transformation, we'll take the affine Jacobian and so on. So this is general for any transformation, because we haven't said what is a w. We just said w is xp. Okay? So you are okay?
Okay. So that is, so this is the Taylor series. Very, very simple idea. Minus t, we either leave it as it is. But just this one, we are replace it. The value of I at p, xp, then the first derivative of this, which is the first derivative of I, then I is function of w, then first derivative of w is a vector value function with respect to p. And that's it. So you know that this gradient is the derivative of the image Ix, Iy, which you have computed many times. You have mask. So we are still at the same place as we were before. So this is the same thing. Now what we want to do is we want to find out delta p such that this is minimized. Okay? So whenever you want to minimize, what you do? You want to minimize a function, you differentiate it with respect to what you want to minimize. You want to minimize with respect to delta p. So we'll differentiate it and equal to 0. So so we want to differentiate. Now this is like a square thing. Suppose this is a whole thing is a big square. So x square. What is the derivative of x square? 2x. Then we differentiate x with respect to something. If you differentiate x with x itself, it's 1. But here, it's not an x, it's a big thing. So that's what we will have. Okay? So the 2 and this whole thing, which is shown here, with the I and all this thing we have here. Now we differentiate inside with respect to delta, with respect to delta p. And as you see, that in this one there's no delta p, okay? In this one there's no delta p. There's only delta p here. So therefore, if you differentiate, it's like some constant and then delta p. So if the derivative of ax is a, right? So that's what we will have. The differential of this one is only this. And since it's a vector, so we're just putting a transpose. So it's very, very easy. The differential of this is that. Because it's a square, 2 and this whole thing, we repeat. Then this is 0, this is 0, we differentiate this. This is constant, and we just put that here. And delta p, with respect to delta p, is 1. So that's it. Then we equate this to 0. And then we find the value of delta p. What do they call this then? One is a delta, and what does this call? Anybody knows? The Greek letter? This is called delta, this is opposite to that. But you get the idea. Nobody knows. Okay. So now when you want to find the this p, yeah, what? Lambda? No.
This one is delta, the other one is gradient.
No, it's the gradient is the, not, that's a Greek letter, Greek. Good, nobody's Greek. Greeks, we should have some Greeks guys. Anyway, so you know, one is upside down. So this is the gradient, this is the, you know, change in P. Okay, so we equate to 0. So it's a just one equation, you know, so we want to keep this term on the left side, we want to move everything on the right side. So this will become Tx minus this, okay, of course multiply with all that, and which is shown here, this Tx minus this, and then delta P has this thing, so we will take this other side, which will become like this, because this is multiplied transpose of that, and then multiply with that itself, you know, which is already here, which came from here. So this will become delta P, and multiply this with that, we will call this H inverse. This will be a matrix, because this is a matrix. We have this, it's just, we say it's H matrix, H inverse. I'm going to talk about that later. It's called Hessian, but I don't want to confuse you right now. So the H matrix, so remember, this was a matrix, the Jacobian, and this is also a vector, so that it'll be a matrix. Then this whole thing will be a matrix, be a 2x2 matrix, okay? So now let's say we want to get the translation, so that's why it's Hessian. So the translation, remember the translation Jacobian was this, 1, 0, 0, 1, and then we will take, and you know, we are removing this homogeneous coordinate, we are getting rid of that, so it's just 2x2. So now if we take this and multiply with the gradient, which is fx, fy, or ix, iy, and you can show that this actually become this matrix, and if you think about carefully, what is this matrix? Actually, this matrix you are using for the homework is Ix square, Ix, Iy, Iy, Ix, Iy square, this matrix. It's used where?
No,
which problem it is used? Harris. This is a Harris corner. See, the same thing. Okay? So, which is good. So, now, so the algorithm to compute the alignment between two frames, which essentially can be translation only, it can be affine, it can be any transformation, you just change the Jacobian, okay? And I give you a list of all the Jacobians, is this. And this does not depend, this does not tell you what is a transformation, because transformation will vary only, this will change. If I use the translation, will be one Jacobian. If I'd use the rigid, it'll be another Jacobian. For affine, it'll be another Jacobian, and so on. And otherwise, this is a very general method to find alignment between two images, two pages. Any, yeah.
Are you missing a parenthesis?
Which one? Where?
By the image term.
Here.
On the right.
Right side?
It looks like it's been there for a few spots.
Yeah, okay. So let me look at my glasses. So we have, see that we have the Tx and minus Iwxp, and this is the difference.
If there's a parenthesis missing.
Where do you want parentheses? Oh, yeah, here. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, because there are two. Yeah, good. I'll do that.
It was a little confusing.
Yeah. Yeah. I will do that. Okay. So we can actually do this right now if you want. Oh,
it went.
But yeah, I don't want to do that because I spend a lot of time. Yeah. Okay. So let's don't do that because, see, I spend about 5 hours to do this kind of thing so that I can explain to you, because I have hidden these things. And I put these things and, you know, it's a lot of time. So, well, I'll ask Barkan to do it. Okay. So yeah, it's good that you're paying attention. So that is what the affine transformation, what is the alignment, to find the alignment between two pages, two images, basically it's upon this equation. And let's look at how we are going to write a program to do it, step by step, there'll be 9 steps. And it's very nice. So first thing we are going to do is we will warp the image I with this warp function. That's what this says. Okay? Then we are going to subtract T from it, which is this term. yes? And then we are going to compute the gradient, you know, which is this one. Then we are going to multiply the, then we are going to evaluate the Jacobian, which is this one, which you know. And then we are going to compute the product of the gradient and Jacobian, which is this one, okay? And then we are going to compute this H matrix, Hessian matrix. And then we are going to multiply H1 is all this thing, and that will give us the delta P, which is shown here. Then we'll add P to delta P, and that's it. So these are the steps. These are the steps you're going to do, and which are shown here. So I can change in this one. Okay, wait. Yeah, in this one, if you want, I can change. Not okay, let's not get into that. Okay, so now the what is very interesting is that this Simon Baker and others, this paper which I told you they wrote to look at what has happened in the last 20 years after Lucas Conrad algorithm was first published. So they came up with actually simplification of this KLT tracker, and which is very interesting, and which actually make this very simple. Again, this has 9 steps, which are shown here, but now what the difference is that we are going to, again, the warp I, but we are going to subtract T from I, so we'll have like this, and we are going to compute the gradient of not I, but T. Then we are going to compute Jacobian, then we are going to compute the multiply the gradient with the Jacobian, compute Hessian, compute this thing, and compute delta P using that, and then we'll update. So what that means that, let me first show you that here. So this is the those 9 steps. So you take this I, warp it, this is your T, you compute the gradient, you compute the Jacobian, it's a kind of fixed, Jacobian doesn't change, then you multiply these, get these, term the descent, and this is your Hessian, and this is the inverse Hessian, and then you take this one and find the difference, multiply, put it here, and come up with delta P, and give you the warp function. So as you see here, the differences are that these operations which are performed on the T, they will be performed only once. You are going to do these 9 steps iteratively. You will keep doing that. Because remember, we'll have initial estimate, we make a delta P, we do this, then we again estimate delta P, we keep adding. So we'll have P0, P1 will be P0 plus delta P, P2 will be P1 plus delta P, and so on. That iteration, 9 steps. So, which means that in that original algorithm which I talked about, where we are computing derivative of I, and we are computing this Jacobian and all this thing for I, we had to do again and again. All these steps we have to do again and again, every iterations. But in this algorithm, what we are doing, that since the T is not changing, T is fixed, the warping is done on I. So we have to do only once. All these steps which are shown in pink, they are doing once, and which will save a lot of your computation. If you don't do that, as shown in this one, we are going T instead of I. See, this is a delta I here, and this is delta T here. This subtraction is from these, subtract I from T from I. Here the subtraction is I from T. So these are change, and that makes it that the what is changing in each iteration is changing the I, because we are warping, as you see here, that we take here, we warp it, applying this one, we do that, we get another warp, then we warp it again. So we are doing this loop here. So I is changing, but T in this case is fixed. We are not doing anything. So these, therefore, these pink steps are fixed. So we'll do only once, and that will save a lot of computation. So that is very interesting that they came up with the simplification, and there's a lot of details in the paper, you know, to justify this, but that makes a lot of difference. Yes?
If you're updating the P, or yeah, step 4, I guess, the mm-hmm. Jacobian?
The Jacobian is because your operation is...
getting the derivative from W with respect to P, and we are updating the P.
Yeah, but P in a way is, yeah, so, okay, so that's one point, but when you came up with that, the Jacobian for different transformation, they dependent on the, on those X and Y are ones or zeros and so on, is that right? There was nothing, it changes, like translation we got 1001. So in that it's really not there's no, in the Jacobian there's no term which has P. See, if you remember those things I showed you here, let's look at that. So these are the Jacobians, is that right? So so here, you know, we don't have anything related to those things. But I think the all these explanations are given in that paper, and we will we may have time to talk about that, but right now they have shown that you can, which is shown, the Jacobian is shown here, as you see in this Jacobian, this is just fixed, you know, it's not, nothing is changing here, and this is also fixed, so we are just using that fixed Jacobian values, we are using it here, but the main thing is that how can you do, instead of finding the gradient of the I, you are finding gradient of T. So that is a big difference. But we will look into those more issues there. But this is pretty nice that you have now very simple algorithm. This was the simplification which simplifies many computation and compared to the way we did before. Now what you need to do is if you look at this delta, the change in parameters which we have here, this equation, you can compare that with what we did with Bergen algorithm. There also we had the affine, and there also we used the Taylor series to get the optical flow considered equation. There we also differentiated with respect to parameters, we equated zero, and you will see they are essentially the same. You know, there's not much different, idea is similar, but these things were done in parallel by different, you know, different authors. So, this is, as I said, this is a very interesting paper here, which is, say, Lucas Knazzi, 20 years on a unifying framework. That figure is taken from there, and then this is explained pretty well in the Zelisky's book, so I took the figures which you have access to, and so then there are also implementations you can get for this tracking in OpenCV, it's a C code, and also there's a MATLAB implementation with Pyramid, and so one thing is that we did not talk about in this thing Pyramid, so we are assuming the motion is small, so we can do without Pyramid. But if the motion is large, then you have to do the pyramid. Like those vectors, you saw the dancing guy, that you cannot do without pyramid. But the whole machinery you can do in pyramid, same thing, you know? So it's okay. And we have these other implementation, affine tracking, Lucas Knuth with pyramid, and so on. So you can look at that. So again, you can, If you do all that, you can do tracking. These are the same sequences I showed you. So, which means that you now know that how can you track a point. Now, if you just have one object, you just want to track that. You don't want multiple points. Then you even don't have to apply the Harris corners, because here we are tracking many points on each object. So you just want to track one point. So just pick a point, arbitrary point, and just do this thing. So this is the dancing thing. As you see, there's a huge motion from frame to frame. So you will need need some kind of pyramid.
So you'd be running alignment on?
On each pair of frames. So you say 1 to 2.
But it's after you found points.
Yeah, so as I said, let's say, take a simple case, you know, where there's a one object moving and you want to track a corner of that object. So you even don't have to apply the Harris detector. Just take a point. Around that point, you find the motion, whether translation or affine, whatever. So you find from 1 to 2, as I explained to you in the first frame. Yeah, so then you repeat the same process for each of the point in parallel. Okay? So here we were tracking one point, so we got this. So let's say we want to track also this point. So we just repeat for that point. You know, we find from here to here, and from here to here, from here to here, then we'll have track for this point like that. We can track this point also like that. So that's, yeah.
And when you're using pyramids, you do the same kind of thing where you're adding the errors.
Exactly same. So see, the best way to understand this thing without pyramid, then you know the pyramid, you just plug in pyramid there. Any more questions? Okay, since we are out of time, think about these questions. You know, we'll again meet Friday, tomorrow, at noon in 101 there, because next Thursday I won't be here. I'm going to miss that, and also the following week. So it's like a makeup class. So come tomorrow at noon. Look at this, all the questions you have, like question Mahdi asked, I'm going to think about that, whether you really need the parameters, you know, the Jacobian to update. And there was one thing that the Jacobian, I show you, it was 2 by 2, which I explained to you, 3 by 2, so I'm going to look at that. Any other question, anything on this lecture? So, you know, we can discuss tomorrow, and if after that we can, you know, move on, talk about other things. Or if you have any questions about the homework, or if you have questions about the SIFT program, we can talk about those also. If you don't have questions, then I will keep, you know, moving forward, cover more material. So if you don't want me to cover much material, then you need to prepare questions, you know, stop me, okay, because I'm going to go like a train. Okay, thank you.